number of years ago, when our kids were little, we were making a trip one summer to Minnesota, where our family has a cabin up there, and we've vacationed there all my life. And it was July. We were living in Las Vegas at the time. July was always a good time to get out of the 115-degree heat in Las Vegas. I know some of you have heard it's a dry heat, but so is a blowtorch. And so we were like out of there in July. And one morning, Barbara and the kids were all sleeping, and we had this big, ugly conversion van, and I was driving across the state of Nebraska on Interstate 80, and they were all asleep. I thought, I'm going to make real good time while they're down. Nobody's asking to go to the bathroom or to stop or anything, you know. So I made real good time until I saw the flashing lights behind me. And so I pulled over, and the officer comes up. I roll down the window, and he said, do you know why I stopped you? And I said, because you need directions to Dunkin' Donuts? No. I didn't say that, okay? I just made that part up. So I said, no, I don't know why you stopped me. He said, well, he goes, this is a 65-mile-an-hour zone. And he said, you were driving miles an hour. And he said, in Nebraska, 65 means 65. And I thought, you must be so proud of your state. And so he started to write me a ticket. And I tried to explain to him that I was a pastor, and I was on vacation, and I was probably just thinking about the Bible or praying or something like that. But he didn't care. And so he writes me this ticket. And a few weeks later, I wrote my check, and I sent in my penalty to the state of Nebraska, and my penalty was paid in full. Now, the next summer, we drove over that same stretch of I-80 again. And do you think I was, like, worried about running into this police officer, like, oh, what if he recognizes me? What if he throws me in jail? You know, he says, hey, there's that guy from Nevada, you know, I'm going to get him. No, not on your life. I wasn't afraid of that. Why? Because my penalty was paid in full. And in fact, I've driven over that stretch of I-80 many times over the years since then, and I don't like sweat it. I don't like carry this big load of guilt when I drive there. I celebrate a time to forget. I celebrate a fact that my penalty has been paid in full. Now, why am I saying this? Here's very important here. I have been praying literally for 2 months now for today. And I have been praying that this day in your life would be a celebration of a time to forget, that you would let go of your past, that you would let go of some things that sometimes keep you kind of living in shame and in guilt. Now, if you have a Bible today, I want to invite you to turn to Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16, you can turn there on your iPod. If you need the text, it's on your outline. If you pull your outline out of your program, you'll see the text there. And I'm going to look at a story of a guy today that I think every one of us will relate to in one way or another. 2,000 years ago, this guy got up one morning, got dressed, you know, probably had his bagel and coffee and went to work. And this day began like any other day in his life, like 1,000 other days. What he didn't know is before he went to bed that night, that this day that began like any other day was going to be a life-changing day in his life. In fact, he and everyone in his household would be celebrating a new spiritual freedom before the day was over. He and everyone in his family, he didn't know it when he got up that day, he and everyone in his family were about to become followers of Jesus. He and everyone in his family were about to be baptized that day that started like any other day. I mean, he and his family started their day in one spiritual condition. They ended their day in another spiritual condition. They started their day dry, and they ended their day wet. Have you noticed some of the greatest moments in your life happen when you least expect it? And I believe, and many of us have been praying for this, that today would be one of those great moments in your life where hundreds of you didn't expect it. I'm going to give hundreds of you the opportunity today to make one of the greatest decisions of your life. I'm going to give you the opportunity to be baptized into Jesus today. I believe what some of you didn't know when you got up and had your bagel and coffee and donut or whatever this morning is that today you were going to be baptized. You say, hey, you're confusing me now, Gene. You mean like the 70 or so people who've already indicated they plan to be baptized today? No, I'm not talking about them right now. We've baptized a lot of people this weekend, and we're going to baptize more, but I'm talking about you being baptized today. You see, oh, you mean you're going to give me the opportunity to sign up for baptism today? No, I'm going to give you the opportunity to be baptized today in Jesus' name. Not in a month, not after you've had 12 weeks of classes. I'm talking about you came here dry today, and you're going to go home dripping wet, baptized in Jesus' name today. Can I get any encouragement for that decision today? And I'm convinced as you look at this guy in Acts chapter 16 today and what happened in his life, many of you are going to be moved in ways that you didn't anticipate. Now, the event that was so catalytic in his life that day was an earthquake. This man was a prison warden, and it was about midnight at the prison in the city of Philippi. And to this point, there was nothing particularly unusual about this night at the prison. I mean, you think about it, every night at a prison is kind of like every other night at a prison. You know, it's not like, hey, we're going to the game tonight or we're going to the movies tonight. No, every night's just like every other night. Maybe one thing that was a little unusual that night is there were a couple of prisoners named Paul and Silas who at midnight were singing and praying. Now, earlier in the day, they had been tortured by this prison warden. They had been beaten by rods. They had been put in chains. Their crime, they were stirring up the city by talking about Jesus. And now it's midnight, and so these two guys, they're singing, they're praying, so they're not your average prisoners. I don't imagine a lot of guys singing and praying in prison at midnight. And so during this night shift, this prison warden, it's late, he's tired, and so he just starts drifting off. He falls asleep. And then the text says, verse 26, suddenly there was a massive earthquake and the prison was shaken to its foundation. All the doors immediately flew open and the chains of every prisoner fell off. A number of years ago, I was preaching on a Sunday morning at a church service in Las Vegas, and in the middle of the sermon that day, an earthquake hit. And it wasn't massive, but the building was rumbling and the light fixtures were swaying back and forth, and there were a lot of spiritual decisions that got made that day. Let me tell you, it was... Well, an earthquake hits the jail. The foundations of the prison start shaking. The prison doors fly open. The chains fall off of the prisoners to set them loose, and this prison warden panics. Verse 27, the jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open. And he assumed the prisoners had escaped, so he drew his sword to kill himself. Now, why is he so desperate? Why is he suicidal at this moment? Well, for one, he was under strict orders to keep his eye on these prisoners, and he was afraid that if they successfully escape, he would be executed for allowing this prison break. That's one reason. But also think about this. Earlier in the day, he had been torturing these guys, beating these guys, abusing these guys, these prisoners, and now they're free. So who might be carrying a grudge against him? Who might be looking for revenge? Who might be coming after him now? And so he thinks, if my superiors don't kill me, these prisoners certainly will after what I've done to them. So he draws his sword to end it all. He's going to kill himself. He'd like to go back and do things differently. He'd like to have a do-over with his life. He wished that he hadn't done these things, but he's guilty. Now, for those of you who are just joining us today, I want to tell you a little background for this series. Last spring, we passed out pieces of paper to everybody here at Eastside. It was Palm Sunday. They were in the shape of a hand. And we asked people to write down on these pieces of paper, what is it in your life that you need the power of Jesus Christ to help you let go of because you can't do it in your own strength? And 2,500 people filled out these pieces of paper, and I saved them. I've got them in this box here, and I've read through all of them. And it was so eye-opening to me what you're carrying in your lives. And themes started emerging, and that's how this series developed: fear and bitterness and doubt. And one of the themes that was so prevalent was the guilt that people in this room are carrying. Let me read to you just some of the examples of what some of you wrote or somebody sitting next to you wrote. My past, all my sins, shame, guilt, lack of trust, sexual impurity, adultery, addiction, hate, inappropriate sex, abortion, anger, divorce, failure, lack of surrender, pride, selfishness, arrogance, my past, the way I lived most all of my life. I am sick of the haunting of my past. This one's written in a child's handwriting, and it says, for lying to my daddy. Addiction to pornography. Letting go of the past. Please pin this on the cross for me, Jesus. It keeps me from the fullness you want to give me. My abortions, my sexual immorality, my waywardness away from you, doing things my way, not your way. Me feeling like a hypocrite always that I still disobey you. Greed, lust, lying, committing adultery, the past, weed, porn, hate. Past mean actions toward my wife, adultery, lust, swearing too much, sins of lying, big and small, my past, lust, envy, pride, arrogance, all my sin and guilt, cheated on my husband when he did it to me. Friends, these aren't something that people out there are carrying. This is what we're carrying in here. All of us have guilt. All of us have things that we carry that we want to let go of, one degree or another. This prison warden is so undone by his guilt, and he's afraid by his past. He's about to say, I just don't want to live another day. I don't want to go on. Some of you have been there. You've been there in life where you have so many regrets. You just, how can I go on? And a millisecond before he thrusts this sword into himself, the prisoner, Paul, says to him, verse 28, stop, don't kill yourself. We are all here. Put down the sword. Don't do what you're about to do. We're not running. We're not escaping. We're right here. There's a better way. Now, I don't think that's what the prison warden expected to hear. In fact, honestly, if I was a prisoner and he had beaten me, stripped me, you know, put me in chains, I think I would have said, go ahead, make my day. Ram it down. But when the warden heard the words, we're still here, it was puzzling to him. And I think he thought, any guys that will spare my life after the way I've treated them, any guys that are singing songs at midnight after I've tortured and abused and chained them, have something extraordinary that I want in my life. Verse 29, the jailer called for lights, ran to the dungeon, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Interestingly, first in this text, it was the earth that was trembling. Now it's this man who's trembling. And it was in this moment of humility, in this moment of brokenness, that he made his first step toward letting go. He decided to come clean and admit his need. He humbly admitted something he'd known for a long time. He admitted his life wasn't working for him. And he asked Paul and Silas the single most important question anybody can ever ask in your lifetime. He says, verse 30, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be set free from this? Now, many of you know, your life isn't working for you on your terms. In fact, that's what drew some of you to this series. And some of you, like this prison warden, you wish you could go back. You wish you could undo some things. You wish you could take what's written on these pieces of paper, and you wish you could erase them all. True story. I was doing a baptism in Vegas one time, and I was in a, you know, jacuzzi for Jesus, much like this, you know, heated, chlorinated. And I came out of the water, and I was dripping wet. And I went back to a changing room, and I reached for a towel, and I pulled out this towel, and I couldn't believe what the towel said on it. In great big block letters right across the middle of it, it said, Holiday Inn. And I laughed to myself, and I thought, now, how did that get here? And I started imagining some scenario of, you know, somebody at home who swiped a Holiday Inn towel. Every time they went to their linen closet, you know, they see that, and they feel guilty about it, and they think, yeah, I'm going to throw that in the trash. And then, no, the trash people would see it, know what a reprobate I am, and maybe they'd report me, and I'd go to jail for stealing the Holiday Inn towel. And so they're carrying this big load of guilt about it. And finally, one day, they thought, I know what I'll do. I'll slip it in the baptism towels at church. Kind of absolve my guilt for this. We all carry guilt from our past, and the Bible is very clear. We all need to be saved. The Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, not even one. Someone said the sin we want to conceal the most is the sin we need to reveal the most. There is no healing in hiding. No healing in hiding. You know what I wonder? I wonder what it's going to take for some of you before you're willing to admit that you have a need and to humbly ask the question, what must I do to be saved? Are you going to wait for an earthquake to happen in your life? Are you going to wait until a tragedy hits? Are you going to wait until a marriage falls apart? Are you going to wait till you kill somebody driving under the influence? Are you going to wait till the health crisis forces you to come to grips with your own mortality? Are you going to wait until you destroy the most important relationships in your life? Are you going to wait till the unplanned pregnancy? Are you going to wait till the sexually transmitted disease? Are you going to wait till you get to the financial brink? Are you going to wait till you get to the emotional brink, the physical brink, the relational brink, the parenting brink? Do you know what? As much as I hate to say this, the answer for some of you is yes, that's exactly what you're going to do. You're going to wait till the earthquake hits. But here's what I know. When it hits, God will be there waiting for you. And God is going to help you start over again, just like he does for this prison warden. This prison warden admits his need. He asked Paul and Silas this most important question of life. What must I do to be saved? And the answer to the question was not long. It was not complicated, but it was profound. Verse 31, they replied, believe. Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. Now, what does it mean to believe? You know, the fact of the matter is, you can believe intellectually that Jesus is God, the Savior of the world, and that won't save you. James 2:9 said that even the demons believe, and they shudder. That's not what Paul and Silas mean when they say, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. They're talking about moving that knowledge that's up here in your head down here to your soul. They're saying, after you come clean and you admit your need, you must humbly believe in the Lord Jesus. Now, can I say something to you? There is so much about Eastside that I'm so excited about today. I mean, this is just such a magnetic place, and God is moving, and, you know, the place is full, and lives are changing, and we've got this bright future ahead of us. And, I mean, there's something magnetic about it, and you just know something supernatural is happening. But sometimes I fear more than a few of you are here out of a jump on the bandwagon mentality, out of kind of a mob mentality. And my concern is that some of you are falsely lured to believing that you are in Christ when you're really just near Christ. You think you're a follower of Jesus when really you're just kind of a fan of Jesus. Friends, there's a big difference between being in a crowd and being personally connected. There's a big difference between joining with the masses and having a personal relationship with the Master. I had a conversation with a very sharp, intelligent, educated, articulate woman a while back who said to me, Gene, I've gone to church my entire life. She named two different denominations that she'd been a part of for years and years and years. And she said, until 3 years ago, no one ever told me I needed to personally accept Jesus Christ and believe in my heart in him. You see, just like this woman discovered, your faith has to move from here about 18 inches south to here. That 18 inches is the difference between carrying a load of guilt and being set free by Jesus Christ. That 18 inches is the difference between that believing Jesus is the Savior and naming him as your Savior. That 18 inches can be the difference between hell and heaven in your life. To believe this in your heart means you totally trust the fact that Jesus Christ is the sinless Son of God, and he made a payment on a cross for you that you couldn't pay for yourself, and Jesus paid it all. And that's exactly what the prison warden does. He comes clean. He admits his need. He humbly believes in the Lord Jesus. And the text indicates in verse 34, just a little later, that that night he and his household rejoiced because all of them had come to believe in God. Not up here, in here. And this inner transformation was so sincere and it was so genuine that look at what happens next. The first part of verse 33. Even at that hour of the night, the jailer cared for them and he washed their wounds. Now, can you feel the irony of that? The drama of that? Who just hours earlier had inflicted those wounds? This prison warden. And now he is so transformed by what God is doing in his heart that now he's washing the wound, he's caring for the wound, he's bandaging the wounds. You see, people who believe in the Lord Jesus, they demonstrate sincerity by heading in a new direction. When a person genuinely believes in their heart and becomes a follower of Jesus, they start depending on God to make some changes in your life. Because after all, if we didn't need to make some changes in our life, we wouldn't need Jesus Christ. My office is on the other side of this campus. It's in a little house, it has some sliding glass doors on one wall that go to the outside. And recently, on a number of different mornings, there's been this little bird that comes up to the sliding glass door. And one day, I just started hearing a pecking. And I thought, what is that? I go over, and there's this little bird outside. And I think, you know, what was happening, he was seeing his reflection in the mirror and thought there was another bird there, thought there was sky behind him. Sometimes then he'd back up, and he'd hit it again, and he'd tap at it, and he'd, and fly. Literally, he would hit this thing and just fall down sometimes. And this didn't happen one day or 2 days. This was happening day after day after day after day. Same bird. And I just finally wanted to say, hey, little bird, maybe it's time you start heading in a new direction with your life. Because this one ain't working for you very well. You see, when a person sincerely believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, it leads to changes in their lives. It's not business as usual. The Bible calls this change, this new direction, repentance. True repentance says, I once beat prisoners, now I tenderly care for their wounds. I once financially cheated people, now I pay them back with interest. I once deceived in business, now I do commerce with integrity, even if it costs me. I once didn't take my marriage vows seriously, now I live with a till death do us part commitment. I once cheated on tests in school, now I do my own work, I get my own grades. Why? Because Jesus died on a cross to set me free from our guilt, from our failures, from our past, and I'm going in a new direction. Somebody posted on my Facebook page the other day a poster that said, you can't reach for anything new if your hands are still full of yesterday's junk. Isn't that good? And I believe some of you here today, you know it's time and that God is calling you to move in a new direction. You need to move towards something new. And by his grace and his forgiveness and his mercy, he sets you free to let go of yesterday's junk so that you can reach for something new. Now look at what happens next, the last part of verse 33. Then he, the jailer, and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. How soon after they came to faith were they baptized? Immediately. Isn't that interesting? Now think about this. It's the middle of the night. Pretty inconvenient. Probably cool, cold, damp. They could say, hey, why don't we wait till tomorrow when the sun's shining? Why don't we do 12 weeks of classes and then we'll do this baptism thing? Maybe I'll be baptized someday when I get around to it. No, they did it right then and there, even in the middle of the night. And on that very night that he admitted his need and he humbly believed in the Lord Jesus, he immediately expressed this newfound freedom, this new release in baptism. And it was the middle of the night. And his family, who was also coming to faith, they were all baptized in the middle of the night. Now let's just review the sequence of what we learned from this guy who's finding freedom from his past. He comes and he admits his need. Life's not working for me. I'm going to take my own life. Then he came to humbly believe in the Lord Jesus. What must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. And he took what was up here and he moved it here. believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved. And then he demonstrated his sincerity by heading in a new direction with his life. And then immediately he expressed this freedom in baptism. Now, question, where are you in this sequence in your life? Some of you say, you know, it's time to come clean. There's no healing and hiding. Got to admit my need. Some of you say, you know, I've done that. It's time to move up here to here, to put my faith in Jesus, saving faith. Some of you say, I've got to demonstrate my sincerity and start heading in a new direction and make some changes in my life and ask God to help me to make those changes. Some of you have yet to be baptized. Some of you have done a couple of these, you've done three of these, one of these. Today, you could do them all. This guy did it all, right then, right there. I'm going to admit my need. I'm going to believe in Jesus. I'm going to head in a new direction today, and I'm just going to express this new freedom in baptism. You know, we got people from a lot of different backgrounds here and a lot of questions about baptism because we come from different backgrounds. Let me hit a couple that are common. A lot of you wonder, why should I be baptized? You know, I could give you many reasons biblically. Honestly, I could, but there's only one that I think any of us should ever need, and that is your leader and your forgiver, Jesus Christ, who died in your place, he asked you to do it. Do we need another reason than that? You know, after Jesus' resurrection, he instructed his followers. He said, when people become followers of me, the first thing I want you to instruct them to do is to be baptized in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And honestly, it puzzles me for anybody who would be reluctant to be baptized when our leader and forgiver who died in our place asked us to do it. And then he even set the example by being baptized first. A couple weeks ago, I was talking about how many sports fans we have here at Eastside, and we got some people on the lunatic fringe, I'm telling you. So I want you to imagine some Eastside sports fan comes up and he says, you know, oh, I love my team, my favorite. I'm there, I never miss a game. I've got season tickets. I'm on the front row. I love my team. But I never cheer for them. I never clap for them. I never wear a t-shirt with my team's logo on it. I never wear a hat. I never wear a sweatshirt because my love for my team, it's a private thing. It's a personal thing. That's nutty, isn't it? If you love your team, you're going to express it. And yet I run into people all the time and say, oh, I love God, man. I got season tickets at Eastside. I'm on the fifth row every week, you know. I'm so fired up for God. But go baptize, you know, come out of the water looking like a drowned rat or something. No, 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 no. That's not for me because my faith, it's a private thing. It's a personal thing. Friends, the Bible says categorically, if you're physically able, you're to be baptized into Jesus because your leader and forgiver ask you to do it and identify yourself visibly with his death and his burial and resurrection. And it's always puzzled me, if you truly love Jesus, if you follow Jesus, why wouldn't you do the first thing he's commanded you to do? Wouldn't it be a pretty awkward moment in heaven to explain to God, oh yes, I loved you, I followed you, but you know, I never had the opportunity, I never had the courage to do the very first thing you asked me to do. Friends, how can you claim to be a follower of Jesus if you're not willing to do that? At Eastside, we take a very literal view of baptism. We take people down into the water because the original word for baptized here in this text and many others is a Greek word called baptizo. It means to dunk. It means to submerge. It means to dip. It means hold them under till they bubble. No, it doesn't mean that. So we take people completely under, though, to represent that we have a Savior who died, and he was buried, and he went into a tomb, and he was buried there for 3 days, and then he rose from the dead, and we come up out of the water of baptism celebrating we have new life in Jesus Christ, and he has forgiven us by what he did on a cross on our behalf. He paid it all. Now, there's another frequently asked question. When am I ready to be baptized? Some of you were baptized as babies, as children. You wonder if you should be baptized again. Others of you have recently decided to follow Jesus, and you wonder, how much do I need to know or learn before you're baptized? So when are you ready to be baptized? Friends, there's a pattern over and over again in the Bible, and we see it in this text in Acts chapter 16. First, the prison warden and his family believed in Jesus. They were at an age where they were old enough to make this decision for themselves. I want to follow Jesus. And then they were baptized. That was the pattern. They believed and then they were baptized. That's when you're ready, after you've believed. Acts 2:41 says, those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church. When did it happen? That day. And 3,000 in all. Acts 8:13 says, Simon himself believed and was baptized. Notice the first thing he did was what? He, and then he was baptized. Yes, in that order. There are 27 times in the book of Acts where someone was baptized, and every single time they first believed, and then secondly they were baptized. And this is an interesting thing. In every case, it was always that day. Not 4 days, not 4 weeks, not 4 years later, that day. Some of us make the mistake of saying, oh, I want to wait to get baptized till I'm worthy, you know, because I got this stuff in my life. I got this thing going on in my life. Well, friends, what we've admitted, we've all got our stuff. We've all got this thing. And when we're baptized, what we're saying is, I can't fix this stuff on my own. I need the power of Jesus Christ in my life. I need His grace. Last September, we were getting ready for a baptism celebration. It was the 4:30 service on Saturday afternoon. And I asked a guy whose name is Walter Gimby if he would lead the way, if he would go first. And he was baptized. And I just want to show you a quick clip of his baptism. Then I want to tell you a little more of his story. Take a look at this. Now, one of the folks who's going to be baptized down here is Walter. Walter, has he already gone back? Walter is standing. And Walter's been coming to Eastside for 4 weeks. He was sprinkled as a child 60 years ago. And he's been convicted of his need to be baptized, and he agreed to go first, just for those of you that, like, haven't seen a baptism, could see one, or for the sake of those of you who, you know, need a little encouragement to see it. So Walter's back there, and Jim's going to baptize him. So Jim, I'm going to ask you now to baptize Walter in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Walter, you're buried with Christ, and you're raised to walk in a new life. How awesome is that? Well, that was an awesome day for Walter. Now, here's what Walter didn't know that day that he was baptized. He had a brain tumor. A month later, he was diagnosed with a brain cancer, which was untreatable. And he went to heaven 12 days ago. And I am so glad, and he was so glad, he made that decision. And last night, we were heading into our 4:30 service. And Walter's son, Grant, who's in his 20s, came to me and he said, Gene, my dad made such an indelible mark on me. Could I go first and lead the way this weekend?